Hi folks, in this video I'm going to be talking about how jazz works, specifically how one particular iconic jazz recording works. It's Miles Davis's recording of Someday My Prince Will Come off his 1961 album of the same name. This is not a totally typical jazz tune in a few respects, but I choose it because the source material is probably at least somewhat familiar to you if you've ever seen Snow White or ever listened to a Greatest Hits of Disney album. If you're not familiar with the version of the song from Snow White, you should pause this video and go listen to it. There's a link in the description below. All right, so if you know anything at all about jazz, then you know that Miles Davis is a supremely cool, intellectual, serious-minded artist. So what is he doing performing a song from a Disney musical? This is an interesting question, and we will talk about this a little bit more. But first, let's go to the actual recording itself. I'm going to start with Miles's performance of the melody. In jazz terms, this is called the head. It's the part of the tune where it's the pre-composed part of the jazz tune. And it's usually the first thing that happens in any given jazz recording. So here it is. So it's interesting to compare that performance to the original from Snow White, and I have Snow White in here so we can listen to them simultaneously. This is going to sound a little peculiar because the recording from Snow White is in G, Miles Davis is playing it in B flat, so I had to transpose Snow White up a minor third. She's already singing pretty high anyway, so she's going to sound like a deranged chipmunk. So just be prepared for that. Here we go. Snow White and Miles Davis together. So one thing that might be apparent to you is Miles phrases the rhythm of this melody very differently from Snow White. There's a thing in jazz called playing behind the beat where you're deliberately like a little bit late on your timing to give the music a laid back feel, but this is not just phrasing behind the beat. I mean, Miles is so far behind the melody, like in this particular phrase. I mean, Miles is an entire measure behind like the written melody. That is really making a statement of kind of creative ownership over this thing. He's like, yeah, I'm so in command of this melody. I don't need to play it remotely like it's written. Yeah, this is a real Miles Davis-ism, is to dramatically transform a written melody to suit his own style. Let's take a look at a picture of Miles Davis if you've never seen one. So there he is. It's worth talking about the role that Miles Davis played in jazz more broadly in this period, at the end of the 50s and the beginning of the 60s. This is a period when jazz was transitioning from being a pop music into being an art music. Now, it was always an art music, right? It was always an art form, but in like commercially and in popular understanding, jazz was very much a dance music and a form of entertainment, certainly in the 1920s, 30s, 40s. Jazz musicians were literally pop musicians. I mean, jazz was just the way that African Americans played pop music and dance music and show tunes and things like that. But starting in the 50s, well, starting in the 40s, really, with Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie and people like that, you start getting this idea of jazz as, you know, this intellectual art form, something that you listen to with your complete attention, not just as like background noise at a bar or something that you would dance to. Miles played with Charlie Parker. He was an early disciple of Dizzy Gillespie. But even Dizzy Gillespie was still kind of an entertainer. Like, he would tell jokes and he would dance and he would sing. Miles Davis didn't none of those things. Miles didn't even make eye contact with the audience. He didn't talk to the audience. He was a serious artist, which again raises the question of what is he doing playing this song? Anyway, let's look at the rest of the recording. So this recording starts in a pretty strange way. There's this long introduction. So this is not typical. I mean, jazz tunes will, you know, often have some kind of introduction, but they usually won't be this long. And also, through this whole intro section, the bass is just playing one note, just playing F, which is the dominant in the key of B flat. Here, by the way, is the bass player, the great Paul Chambers, Mr. PC. John Coltrane wrote this tune for him. The drummer, Jimmy Cobb. The time that they're playing is pretty interesting. Most jazz tunes are in 4/4 time, meaning you count 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. But Someday My Prince Will Come is in 3. It's a waltz. So you're counting 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. So each one of these measures that we're seeing is 3 beats long. Played by Wynton Kelly, the great Wynton Kelly. There he is. So that pedal, that F pedal, keeps carrying on right through this first hunk of the melody. And when it finally relaxes, it's quite a relief of tension, right? So after this point right here, Paul Chambers switches from playing this F pedal to just playing the roots of the chords, which is the more normal thing for a jazz bass player to be doing. So if you're a reader of chord charts, I put the chords down here. If you don't know what these symbols mean, I did a little color coding. So this first chord, B flat, that's the tonic chord. It's home base in the key of B flat. And whenever the tune lands on this B flat chord, there's this feeling of like resolution, this feeling of coming home. So the way this tune works is it starts on B flat, starts on the tonic, then it goes through all these other chords, all these other chords, all these other chords, lands back on B flat at the beginning of the next section. All these other chords, all these other chords, all these other chords, back to B flat at the beginning of each section. So the tune itself is 16 bars long, and it's divided into, no, I'm sorry, it's 32 bars long. Like most jazz tunes. It's divided into these two 16-bar sections, the A section and the B section. And what's going to happen in the rest of this recording, or most of the rest of this recording, is Miles Davis and the rest of his horn players are going to play solos on this tune, meaning they're going to improvise new melodies for the chord changes of Someday My Prince Will Come, using the form of Someday My Prince Will Come. So in other words, they're going to improvise these melodies that are 32 bars long, divided into these two 16-bar sections, following this same chord progression all the way through. This is a 9-minute recording, and this statement of the melody is only about 30 seconds long. So most of this recording, most of the time, is spent improvising these new melodies. And that's pretty much what the point of jazz is, right, is to improvise new melodies. So the first solo is Miles. He's going to play three choruses, meaning he's going to play through this 32-bar form of the tune three times. And you can keep track of what he's doing by just mentally singing the melody along with him. So I'm going to do that for a little bit. Here we go. So I'm not going to sing anymore, but you get the idea. You can hear there's places where his improvised melody is following the rhythmic phrasing of the original. There's places where it sounds like he's kind of playing a counter melody to the original, knowing that you have the original in your mind. So let's listen to it without me singing. So notice he leaves a lot of long pauses, right? So that's deliberate. He's doing that to create suspense, or like he's doing it to give you this feeling of that he's deliberate, that he's not hurried, that he's not stressed out, but he's not even really trying that hard to impress you. We should also talk about his trumpet sound. It's a very distinctive one. Miles is using this thing called a harmon mute, which is this metal thing that you stick into the bell of the trumpet. And like the name implies, it was designed to make the trumpet quieter, but it also gives it this strange timbre, this kind of thin, reedy, metallic kind of sound. And Miles used it to give this kind of introverted, almost kind of lonely feeling to his trumpet sound. It's pretty remarkable. Anyway, here's the next part of the solo. Check out this note, dissonant, yeah. All right, so now we're getting into the second chorus. So this is the second time through. So, Someday my prince will come. And as he goes along, he's going to start introducing more and more dissonance, more and more like wrong notes. And the mark of a really good creative jazz musician is the ability to play wrong notes, but do it in a way that actually makes sense in context. So this is this nice balance, right? He's got this very abstract, weird, kind of dissonant passage, and then followed by just a direct quotation of the original melody. This is my favorite thing in his whole solo, this little riff. So he's just playing one note, do B flat, but he's playing it in this kind of funky syncopated pattern, and you can really hear Wynton Kelly like responding to him by playing the underlying chords in this kind of funky syncopated way. And like the whole point of jazz, right, is this like live interplay, the spontaneous reaction to the other musicians. So at the end of this chorus, at the end of his third chorus, he repeats that one note riff from the end of the second chorus, and he likes it so much that he just keeps playing it right through the end of the form and into the beginning of the next solo. Okay, so the next solo belongs to Hank Mobley, who is the tenor sax player in Miles's band at this time. Here he is. I am going to say some not very complimentary things about Hank Mobley in a second, and it's important to put them into context. Hank Mobley is one of the great jazz tenor sax players of all time. He's got a beautiful kind of lyrical sound. As a leader, he made a bunch of terrific albums. There's this one called Soul Station. You gotta go check it out. Just really a beautiful classic bebop album. However, he was new to Miles Davis's band, and he was replacing John Coltrane, who we will be hearing about in a little bit. And he just was not the right fit for this band. Yeah, and he didn't last super long in it. He's kind of Jimi Hendrix and the Beatles. Like, Miles has this very kind of acidic, remote kind of intellectual style, and Hank's kind of, warm, accessible, kind of lyrical thing is just not a terrific match for it. And in this recording, he's not really at the top of this game. So here is Hank Mobley's solo. So that was fine. I mean, look, that was much better than I could have done for sure. But yeah, it definitely doesn't have that super distinctive edge that Miles has. Now that was kind of a long pause, and that was not like a Miles Davis pause where he's just like, deliberately waiting. That sounds more like he's not totally sure what to play next. Yeah, there again, it really just sounds like he's run out of ideas. Wynton Kelly knows how to fill the space in a way that makes it sound good, but yeah. And this is part of the excitement of jazz, right? Is that it's an improvised art form. So it's always a little bit uncertain, like what is going to happen when tape starts rolling. And the possibility of it not going incredibly well is the thing that makes it so exciting when it does go well, right? Again, Hank Mobley, I'm sorry. Soul Station, really one of my favorite albums ever. But yeah, this is not totally confident. So anyway, next we've got Wynton Kelly's piano solo. Okay, so now instead of getting to do the second half of his second chorus, Miles comes back in and plays the second half of the melody. That's a little bit unusual. What happens after that is this interlude, which is a reprise of the intro with that F pedal tone. And what's going to happen after that is John Coltrane solo. And it seems like Miles is, he just wants to do a little kind of palate cleansing to get you ready for Coltrane. Sorry, we should talk before we listen to it about who Coltrane is. All right, so even if you're not like a super huge jazz fan, you've probably heard the name John Coltrane. Yeah. Possibly the best jazz tenor saxophone player, right? Possibly the best jazz musician ever, depending on your tastes. And Coltrane had been in Miles Davis's band on and off for 5 years, but shortly before this recording was made, he had left to start his own unbelievably great band. And so, like I said, poor Hank Mobley was his replacement. And but he Coltrane happened to be in the building the day that they were recording this track, and Miles was like, "Oh, Coltrane, come in." And what I think might have happened is, I don't know if I read somewhere, and I wish I could source this, but I believe they might have like spliced him in afterwards, and Miles actually might have played the piano part under him. Certainly, the piano playing sounds a little bit different under this next interlude and under Coltrane solo, but unfortunately, I can't find a reference for that, so I don't know whether it's true. Anyway, here is Coltrane solo. Well, first here is Miles. Reprise of the head, and then this interlude, and then Coltrane's. Pause right there. So there's a lot going on in here. Yeah. So for one thing, you can hear, even though they're both playing the tenor saxophone, Hank Mobley and John Coltrane have very different sounds. Hank Mobley has this kind of breathy, kind of laid back sound, and Coltrane is a lot harder and more insistent. Some critic described him as sounding like a preacher, which I think is accurate. This is a real Coltraneism, is to jam in a whole bunch of notes really fast, playing a very kind of dissonant and weird, like chord extension. let's pause right there. Okay, so this is all whole passage of really berserk double timing, meaning playing like implying a tempo that's twice as fast as what everybody else is playing. But that is not the thing you should be impressed by. Like, at this point, any kid coming out of Berkeley can play the saxophone that fast. The thing that's remarkable about Coltrane's double timing is he doesn't sound like he's working any harder. Like, he sounds just as relaxed and laid back as when he's playing that more kind of ballady feel from the beginning of a solo. And also, he's not just throwing notes around to fill space. Like, even when he's double timing, these melody lines all make sense. Like, they have a real arc and a shape to them. And it feels very considered, even though he's playing insanely fast. And if you slow these things down, they actually do sound quite good. Yeah, so the thing that separates Coltrane from, you know, all the nerds coming out of music school now is that, you know, he's able to balance this kind of very chopsy technical playing with this, you know, these lovely kind of lyrical melodic passages, and to keep, you know, soul through the whole thing, to keep blues feel through the whole thing. Coltrane, unfortunately, had a really tragic life, even by jazz musician standards. He died, I think, less than 9 years after this album came out. And it was an action-packed 9 years. I mean, in that 9 years, he made, you know, this unbelievable stack of mind-boggling jazz albums, and died when he was 41 years old, which, yeah, it's a sad story. But I guess we were lucky to have him for the amount of time that we did. Anyway, so after Coltrane solo, we get another little interlude, another little reprise of the intro, and then the head out. And so most jazz recordings start with the head, with the melody, and then end with the head out, which is just another statement of the melody. And here, Miles only plays the second half of the melody for the head out. Oh, sorry. There's that weird sound that someone makes for some reason. I don't know why. I assume they were probably planning to just, you know, vamp on this thing for some unspecified length of time and then fade out. And then decided, no, actually, we should keep the whole thing in there, including that little at the end. All right, so that is Miles Davis's recording of Someday My Prince Will Come. Let's go back to this question of what Miles was doing recording this tune in the first place, because it really is not an obvious repertoire choice for him. Now, in general, right, jazz is based on pop music, even in this more kind of artsy intellectual period that Miles is representative of. They're still playing tunes like Autumn Leaves and All the Things You Are. And, you know, these tunes are not familiar now unless you're a jazz aficionado. But at the time, you know, listeners would have been like, oh, Autumn Leaves, I've heard that a billion times, sung by, you know, Joe Stafford or Frank Sinatra or Bobby Darin or whoever. So they would have been familiar with these tunes. And, you know, the point of the jazz versions would be to comment on, you know, on these, you know, kind of trite, familiar tropes. So maybe that's what Miles is doing, just like, well, this is a familiar tune. And maybe there's some irony here, like, but this doesn't sound like he's making fun of the tune to me. This sounds more like, he's like, yeah, well, maybe this is kind of a corny tune, but there's potential in here to actually really make it beautiful if we just, you know, make the rhythm a little cooler and make the chord changes a little clunchier, things like that. And Miles actually recorded a bunch of extremely corny-seeming material over the course of his career. Like, he did Surrey with the Fringe on Top from Oklahoma. That recording is beautiful. And Coltrane did this, too. Like, I mean, Coltrane's famous recording is My Favorite Things, right, from The Sound of Music. And Coltrane's version of that is mind-boggling. So, you know, I think what's going on here is Miles saying, yeah, yeah, I can sound cool when I'm playing some intricate bebop head, you know, something written by a jazz musician, but you know what is really cool? If I take something that you don't realize is actually good and, you know, find the beauty in it, and find the hidden potential in it. And I hear a real continuity between that idea and the way that like a really good DJ will approach a pop song, or the way that like a rap producer will approach like a sample from like light fusion jazz. There's this term in African-American folklore vernacular, signifying, like Henry Louis Gates wrote a book about it called The Signifying Monkey, where you're taking something familiar, but you're putting your own kind of spin on it, and maybe that spin is sarcastic or parodic, but the idea is to take some sort of communal cultural property and use it as a vehicle for expressing your own kind of distinct ordinary personality. So whether Miles is being ironic or not, he's pretty clearly signifying on Someday My Prince Will Come. So I chose this recording to talk about just A, because I love it, but B, because it's something that is more likely to be familiar to you. The source material is more likely to be familiar to you than something like Autumn Leaves or All the Things You Are. What makes it difficult to get into jazz is that most of us are not familiar with the material that the jazz musicians are signifying on. Like for me, you know, I heard Autumn Leaves first being played by jazz musicians, and only later did I go and check out versions of it being sung by like conventional pop singers. So yeah, it's hard to sort of get started with these abstractions of abstractions of pop songs without being familiar with the pop song. So I like this as an entry point to jazz because it's somewhat more likely that you have seen Snow White and have heard the original version of the song. If you want to go deeper into jazz, a good way to do that is to listen to other people playing this song. There's a great Dave Brubeck version. Miles Davis may have gotten the idea to do the song from Dave Brubeck's version because Miles is a Dave Brubeck fan. Oscar Peterson does it. More recently, Cassandra Wilson recorded a really interesting version of it. So you can really understand a lot about the very different styles of these various musicians by comparing the way they all approach the same source material. So, yeah, that's it. Thanks for listening.